Tonight on NewsWatch, the American economy. New reports showing the country's economic improvement.
Plus, the gun control debate wages on. Why the president says it's an issue he won't be letting go.
And meet a man who's bringing hope to a war-torn region of Russia. All this and much more tonight on NewsWatch. Good evening, everyone. I'm Wendy Griffith.
And I'm Mark Martin. The U.S. job market is improving despite higher taxes and government spending cuts. U.S. employers added 165,000 jobs in the month of April, reducing the unemployment rate from 7.6% to 7.5%. And that's a four-year low. The report from the Labor Department shows the only sectors that cut jobs last month were construction and government. On news of these latest numbers, the Dow Jones Industrial Average hit an all-time high today. It broke the 15,000 mark for the first time. While the economy may be looking better, some say they aren't seeing it. Analysts say it's a matter of expectations.
I think we're doing better than the rest of the world, and for now, that's good enough.
Today's jobs report is already helping to soothe fears of another spring economic slowdown.
Joining us now to talk about the economy is Scott Paul, president of the Alliance for American Manufacturing. Well, today's report puts a positive spin on the economy, but none of the jobs created were in the manufacturing sector, and you say that's a bad sign. Tell us why.
That's right, Wendy, because manufacturing is the bulk of middle-class employment in this country, and if you look at the jobs numbers breakdown, we saw tremendous job growth in the service sector. In fact, 185,000 jobs. However, most of those are very low-wage jobs. You can't sustain a family, own a house, buy a car in many of those occupations. The goods-producing jobs like manufacturing, construction, mining, you saw lose jobs, and in manufacturing it was dead even. In fact, we've seen little manufacturing job growth over the past year, despite all this talk of a resurgence in manufacturing. It's yet to show up in the data quite yet.
Scott, President Obama said he wanted to create a million new manufacturing jobs in his second term. You have some ideas of how that can be accomplished. Have any of them been implemented so far?
It's a very good question, and I do think that we can get to a million manufacturing jobs. Part of that depends on economic conditions, which of course are out of control of Capitol Hill and the president, but there are a lot of things that Washington could be doing to help. First, provide resources for workforce training. I need to get skilled workers into these positions. Second, invest in our infrastructure. We have 70,000 bridges that are in desperate need of repair, for instance. Third, we need to invest in innovation to make sure that we have the research and development available to make high-tech goods in this country. And last but not least, we need a level playing field on trade. We continue to run up very high trade deficits,
Scott,
with countries like China and Japan.
Let me ask you this real quick. We just have 30 seconds left. Will any new jobs be created, any new manufacturing jobs be created in the near future?
I'm hopeful because I do think that we'll see housing starts move up. We'll see people continue to buy new automobiles as their automobiles age. So I'm cautiously optimistic, but I do think we need the right policies from Washington on taxes and those other issues that I mentioned as well.
All right, Scott Paul with AAM. Thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you.
Mark?
President Obama is vowing not to stop pushing for new, tighter gun control rules in the U.S. He says the recent defeat of his proposals in Congress was, quote, just the first round. Meanwhile, as the gun debate rages on, the National Rifle Association's annual convention begins today.
The NRA convention in Houston could be the largest in the organization's history.
We're stronger than we've ever been.
David Keene is the president of the NRA. The convention is underway in the midst of the ongoing national debate over guns and the Second Amendment, a debate fueled by the school shooting in Connecticut last year and failed gun control legislation in the Senate last month.
Guns are not the problem. The people who misuse firearms are the people who shouldn't have them. They're the problem.
Keene says mental health is the real issue. New Hampshire Senator Kelly Ayotte agrees and believes the bipartisan proposal to expand background checks for firearms sold online and at gun shows would not prevent another shooting like what happened at Sandy Hook Elementary School.
Ultimately, mental health is an area that, particularly in these mass violence situations, we should, I think, be able to come to some improvements on.
Gilles Rousseau traveled to New Hampshire to talk with Ayotte. He came on behalf of his daughter, Lauren, a first grade teacher killed at Sandy Hook.
I feel I have to do something, not to avenge, but to, for my daughter. I'm doing it for my daughter. I hope we can prevent any of this in the future.
Michelle Green is with the Houston chapter of a group called Moms Demand Action that formed after the Sandy Hook shooting. They say they're bipartisan and made up of gun owners and non-gun owners. Green says their goal is what they call common sense gun laws.
So that we make sure that criminals aren't easily able to access guns, to make sure that we don't have weapons out that that can cause the kinds of damage like we saw at Newtown.
Around 80,000 people are expected to attend the NRA convention this weekend.
Investigators say the suspects in the Boston bombing had a different target in mind, not the Boston Marathon, but rather an attack on the 4th of July. And the government is hoping to find more information about the bombers from a notebook computer that they've recovered. Charlene Israel has the story.
The Boston plot continues to unravel. Authorities say the surviving suspect, Jokhar Tsarnaev, told investigators that the original target was a Boston 4th of July celebration. But he and his brother Tamerlan finished building their bombs sooner than expected. That's when they decided to attack the Boston Marathon instead. And another development in the case. Feds say they've recovered Jokhar Tsarnaev's laptop. Three of Jokhar's friends have been accused of throwing away and withholding evidence and information. But one of their attorneys says his client handed the laptop over the first time agents came to see him.
I'm not sure a 19-year-old college student understands the gravity of such a situation like this. And they did not intentionally or knowingly destroy evidence.
The three friends face a maximum sentence of between 5 and 8 years in jail if convicted.
He was a good kid, definitely a good kid. And I guarantee you that he most likely had no knowledge of what he was doing. He made a stupid decision because he knew the guy.
Meanwhile, investigators have a new link to radical Islamic terrorists. Jokhar confessed that he and his brother watched internet sermons of American Al-Qaeda cleric Anwar al-Awlaki. And authorities continue to investigate a 2012 trip that Tamerlan Tsarnaev took to Dagestan, Russia. They say he met with known Islamist militants while he was there. Feds are also investigating a post-bomb phone call Tamerlan made to his wife, Catherine Russell. She denies having any knowledge of the attacks. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Rhode Island is now the 10th state to legalize gay marriage. Governor Lincoln Chafee signed the bill on the steps of the state house Thursday. Chafee says the law giving homosexuals the right to marry lives up to the ideals on which the state was founded. He referred to the state's charter of 1663.
I said, when marriage equality is the law in Rhode Island, we honor our forefathers who risked their lives and fortune in pursuit of human equality. I believe those words just as much today as I did then, and now I am proud and humbled to make Marriage Equality Act the law of the land in Rhode Island.
Rhode Island state charter is considered the first ever to grant citizens religious freedom. The charter also says its founders were dedicated to, quote, edifying themselves and one another in the holy Christian faith and worship.
Maryland is the latest state to abolish the death penalty. Democratic Governor Martin O'Malley signed a bill Thursday repealing the law and replacing it with life in prison without parole. Maryland is the 18th state to ban the death penalty, the first state south of the Mason-Dixon line to do so.
a desperate fight in Southern California where a massive wildfire is burning out of control. At least 1,000 firefighters are on the ground, but still homes, businesses, and thousands of acres are being burned in the flames.
This right here.
Our idea is to hit it hard, hit it fast, and keep it as small as possible.
The fast-moving wildfire is threatening more than 2,000 homes. Experts say the threat could extend to the Southwest and mountain states.
Coming up, how Israelis relate to the trauma of terror attacks like the one in Boston.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
He promised healthcare for everyone. But now, seniors are getting hit with more than $700 billion in Medicare cuts. Insurance costs are going up. Businesses say they can't afford Obamacare, so they'll pay big fines and millions of employees could lose their healthcare. Plus, everyone pays hidden taxes and fees, as much as 40% on some health plans. But you can get the truth. Get the brand new book, The Obamacare Survival Guide. It's number one on Amazon and a New York Times bestseller. Inside, you'll discover hundreds of loopholes, tips, and strategies to survive Obamacare now. Join the more than 250,000 people who've claimed their copy and get yours before it's too late. Go to Obamacare911.com. The Obamacare Survival Guide will give you hundreds of tips on how to save money and protect yourself. You can pick up your copy in bookstores for only $19.95 or have your copy rushed to your door for the internet-only price of just $4.95. Go to Obamacare911.com to claim your copy now.
The U.S. is calling on North Korea to release a Korean-American sentenced to 15 years hard labor. Kenneth Bay is a devout Christian from Washington State.
Part of our concern here, and we've had longstanding concerns, about the lack of transparency and due process in the North Korean legal system. We urge the DPRK authorities to grant Mr. Bay amnesty and immediate release.
Bay was arrested in November near the border of China and Russia. He's accused of committing what North Korea describes as hostile acts against the state. But it's believed his sentencing is nothing more than a political ploy by the North Korean regime. Bay is the sixth American held there since 2009.
Many in America will feel trauma from the Boston Marathon bombing for a long time. It's a feeling Israelis understand. Just a few years ago, they endured one of the worst terror campaigns in modern history, and they still live with the threat of terror. Many say it's been a learning experience, one that can teach America. Here's Chris Mitchell from Jerusalem.
The frightening images from the Boston Marathon bombing went global in a matter of hours. For many Israelis, it brought back memories of their own terror attacks. Take a walk around Jerusalem and you'll find memorials like this one. They mark the many terror attacks that happened during a period known as the Second Intifada. From September 2000 to 2004, nearly 1,000 Israelis died in those attacks and thousands more were wounded. This stone commemorates an attack on February 22, 2004. 8 Israelis died in that attack, including 2 18-year-olds.
It's a terrible thing to have so much pain and suffering and families really changed forever from this kind of an event. And such a fun event, as I remember as a child, going out onto Com Ave and watching the marathon, that kind of event will have that memory associated with it.
Debbie Garner grew up in Boston and now lives in Israel with her family. She knows what it's like to live in the terror shadow.
You know, you realize that sort of welcome to the club. You know, we live it day to day, and now unfortunately Boston's sort of into that club and having to take precautions that maybe weren't having to be taken in previous years.
This is something that maybe one of the biggest lessons that the Americans can and should learn practically from that horrific event.
Terror expert Boaz Ganor admits it's almost impossible to screen every spectator in an event like the Boston Marathon.
But there is another tier of activity, and this is public awareness. Some refers to that as resilience. I think that public awareness in counterterrorism is an integral part of resilience. And the American is resilient in many ways, but on that respect, they need to be much more resilient and much more aware to their surroundings.
Police officer Mickey Rosenfeld saw public awareness in action. A local shopkeeper noticed a suspicious package, called police, and warned bystanders.
I remember that specific day being at the scene, which was in March in 2011. When the phone and the line was still open, he also asked members of the public to move out of the area because of this suspicious bag and suitcase. And what happened was, when he was on the line, so the explosion took place, and in fact, if he wouldn't have moved those members of the public out of the area, a lot of people would have been killed that day.
One person died and dozens were wounded, but it could have been much worse.
But that just goes to show what it is about public awareness, that as soon as people see a bag or an object, immediately they call the police, and in fact work specifically in the first few seconds in order to try and make sure that people aren't in any specific danger.
While these things may be second nature for Israelis, Garner feels these lessons must be taught around the world.
So I think, first of all, everyone should be aware of their surroundings at any point in time, wherever you are in the world. I mean, one day it's Boston, one day it's Tel Aviv, and one day it's Kathmandu. You know, you really don't know what's going to happen any day. But not to live life in panic or in fear all the time either. And certain precautions need to be taken.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Up next, why one Russian thug turned to a life of violence and then renounced it.
From CBN.
Broken Eardrum is playing at the Civic tonight.
And you'll just have to miss it.
This is so incredibly unfair.
A special story of love and sacrifice.
Joy, Mom comes up with something.
Christopher Quantum, you and I are going to discuss your attitude right this minute. Superbook.
No.
Join the Superbook DVD Club and get Superbook's newest episode, He Is Risen. Plus, two copies to share with others, all for your gift of $25.
They have arrested Jesus, the Messiah. Do you not know that I have the power to crucify you?
No! Please! You can't!
They've taken him to Golgotha. We must hurry.
Mary is about to lose her son, the worst thing any mother could face. I am not leaving her.
Superbook. It's an amazing way to build a strong spiritual foundation in the children you love.
Mary, who are you looking for?
I've seen him! He is alive!
Superbook. He is risen. Available now.
Ow, my feet hurt.
My feet hurt, your feet hurt. White hot pain, I wanna cry. Is there anything I can try?
Why, yes. Introducing Strut Soul Angels, the human shock absorber that helps alleviate foot pain.
The first 10 steps in the morning to the bathroom were excruciating. Within 3 days after I put Struts on, it's been such a relief.
Slipped it on and almost immediately I felt a support, kind of like a pillow underneath my arches.
The Struts Soul Angel provides a great amount of relief and support throughout the course of the day, providing shock absorption and relief of pain.
On your feet without proper support can be painful. Struts Soul Angels promotes better balance, control, and body alignment. Standing in your heels all day is painful, but slip on Struts and you'll enjoy comfort and support 24/7. Struts is so versatile, you'll wear them in every shoe you own, even barefoot.
I'm on my feet all the time. I teach 11 and 12-year-olds. The pain was so much that I knew I had to do something. And with the Struts, I can do my job and enjoy my job.
I usually am on my feet from 8 to 12 hours a day. When I wear my Struts, it's like giving my feet a hug all day.
It's life-changing. I wear them from the minute I get up
to the minute I go to bed.
Why pay $400 for custom orthotics?
Now get Strut Sole Angels for just $10. You also get Miracle Foot Repair Cream, absolutely free. Use it to help relieve dry, callous feet overnight. But wait, call right now and we'll double the offer free. Just pay separate processing and handling. Plus, you get a 100% money-back guarantee. If not completely delighted, send it back, but keep the foot cream as our gift just for trying. You get it all, a $70 value for just $10.
Oh, yes! Love my struts, the best thing since sliced bread. They heal pain from toes to head. Get yours now, your doctor said.
Struts, be nice to your feet. Call now.
Call 1-800-787-1580 and get your struts and miracle foot repair for just $10 and we'll double the offer. That's 1-800-787-1580 or visit getstruts.com.
Chechnya and Dagestan. Before the bombings in Boston, many Americans had never heard of these Russian provinces. Now we know the suspects came from that area.
Yeah, Muslims there have been fighting a brutal rebellion since the late 90s. Thousands have been killed.
But one man is on a mission to bring peace and the gospel to this war-torn region. George Thomas has tonight's Focus Report.
Gennady Turkun is not proud of his past, and he gets uncomfortable talking about it.
I left home when I was 13 years old and got entangled with the wrong crowd. I did a lot of things that I'm ashamed of.
He's from the small Russian city of Krasnodar. His life reads like a Hollywood mafia thriller. Drugs, armed robbery, prostitution, hired assassin, money laundering, gun smuggling, you name it, Turkun did it all. And then some.
It's as if I became the devil's slave. I even remember making a pact with Satan to serve him.
And his deeds eventually caught up with him.
I was arrested and sentenced to 20 years in prison.
That's the past. And to witness the power of a life transformed by God, look no further than Gennady Turkun. The year was 1987. The former Soviet Union faced huge political changes, and a young Turkun sat in prison.
I had a bad reputation in prison as someone who had special cult-like powers. Prisoners were even afraid of me.
One day, some Christians came to share the love of Jesus. Turkun says it was the first time he had ever heard the gospel message. But it took 4 years for it to sink in.
In 1991, I realized its true meaning. I dropped to my knees in the prison cell and told God I was a sinner. I didn't want to live one single day without him in my life. From that moment, I went from serving Satan to a servant of Jesus.
The prison miraculously shortened his sentence by 5 years. And he was released in 1996. The day after he walked out of prison, he walked into a Bible training seminar organized by Russian ministries, which focuses on bringing the gospel to the former Soviet Union.
Russian ministries was very instrumental in my life. Their classes taught me how to share my new faith with others. They also put in me a missionary heart to plant churches and help train the next generation of leaders in my country.
He was baptized shortly thereafter. Now, for more than 10 years, Turkun has been leading a church in the predominantly Muslim Northern Caucasus region.
I am convinced that it is the love of Christ that can turn this region around.
That's a tremendous show of faith because Islamic radicals have waged a bloody insurgency here for years. In that time, two wars and scores of terrorist attacks have killed thousands and displaced many more. Turkun's goal? Reach this war-torn region with messages of reconciliation and forgiveness. One way is to reach young people. Turkun coordinates dozens of youth camps each year in partnership with Russian ministries and local congregations. Di Gusalova is a member of Turkun's church and helps with the camps.
These kids have to know there is an alternative lifestyle to violence. We spend time playing games with them, handing out gifts and building relationships. It gives us an opportunity to share the gospel.
Many parents say the camps are godsend.
I love it when they talk about peace and getting along with other ethnic and religious groups. They're helping to build bridges, and this is important.
In one city, the local Communist Party even took out full-page newspaper ads promoting the youth camps.
You may be surprised, but there are many Christians in the Communist Party. We believe that the messages of Christ can give these kids a brighter future.
When he's not coordinating camps or preaching, Turkun trains local believers to become the future leaders here.
It's all about missions and church planting.
Working in the Northern Caucasus is not without its hardships. It includes the volatile region of Chechnya, where Muslim militants and Russian forces have battled back and forth to control the province. There is relative peace now, but Islam's influence is growing.
With the help of the Russian government and several Muslim countries, including Saudi Arabia, Chechnya has today erected what could be the largest mosque in Europe. For evangelical Christians living in this province, life for them can not only be challenging, but potentially dangerous.
Ramza has firsthand experience. CBN News agreed to conceal his identity for protection.
I've been repeatedly warned by Muslim radicals and local authorities to stop preaching, but I will not. I'm a simple man whose life was one day touched by Christ. I have a responsibility to tell others about him, no matter the cost.
It's the price that Ramza, Gennady, and the other believers are willing to pay to bring lasting peace.
God changed my life in prison that day for a reason, and this is it: to bring love and hope to these regions.
George Thomas, CBN News, in Grozny, Chechnya.
God is on the move. Well, up next, the ice cream truck battle that's whipping up some icy competition in mid-state New York.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
He promised health care for everyone. But now, seniors are getting hit with more than $700 billion in Medicare cuts. Insurance costs are going up. Businesses say they can't afford Obamacare, so they'll pay big fines and millions of employees could lose their health care. Plus, everyone pays hidden taxes and fees, as much as 40% on some health plans. But you can get the truth. Get the brand new book, The Obamacare Survival Guide. It's number one on Amazon and a New York Times bestseller. Inside, you'll discover hundreds of loopholes, tips, and strategies to survive Obamacare now. Join the more than a quarter of a million people who've claimed their copy and get yours before it's too late. Go to Obamacare911.com. The Obamacare Survival Guide will give you hundreds of tips on how to save money and protect yourself. You can pick up your copy in bookstores for only $19.95 or have your copy rushed to your door for the internet-only price of just $4.95. Go to Obamacare911.com to claim your copy now.
And finally, sounds of the local ice cream truck remind many of us it's almost summertime.
But the happy tunes have landed on a sour note in one New York neighborhood. Believe it or not, there's an ice cream war brewing in the city of Gloversville, Wendy. Mm. Police say that a rival truck has been harassing the local ice cream man, coming up behind him, blaring loud music and offering free treats. They say it's gone way beyond friendly competition.
It is a rather unique situation. One of our officers actually witnessed one of the ice cream trucks following the other ice cream truck. He had two vehicles, two ice cream trucks, and they were both engaged in that course of conduct.
And get this, police later arrested the rival driver on stalking and harassment charges. They say it just goes to show how serious some people take their ice cream.
Oh my word.
Yeah, wow. He was wanting to make a buck.
You were arrested for selling free ice cream.
Yeah, stalking and harassment too. That's all for this edition of NewsWatch.
We'll see you next week. Have a great weekend. Good night.